those who want to be a civil servant. So I don't have to tell you the idea why you should be a civil servant, but I can just test how deeply you are into this choice by asking you as to what is the population of the country. Mics, please circulate the mics for whoever wants. What's the population of the country today? 130 crores. What is the number of IAS officers in the country? The strength of IAS officers in the country is about 5,000. Now tell me, one IAS officer represents how many people in the country? Or has the responsibility to take care of at least on an average how many lakhs of people in the country? Quick calculation. 4 lakhs? 40 lakhs. Right? Good answer. Get up. Tell me your name. What's your name? Speak it in the mouth.
I'm Nirmal Rani.
Yeah, Nirmal Rani. Big hand for Nirmal Rani. I just did this test because this is what it takes to be an IAS officer. Sharp mind, quick decision making, very good expression, right? And this is the time to start preparing for it. When I was in my 10th standard, my father guided me to start preparing for the civil services, and that's how very steadily I went on preparing till I became 21 years of age. And in my first attempt, I could make it into the civil services as a woman chopper. Gives great satisfaction because when you work hard and when you are consistent, success has to be yours. For the benefit of all my young friends, I've written a couple of books. In Kannada, it is Nimma Bhavishya, Nimma Kaiyalli. In English, Your Future in Your Hands. Since my subject was psychology, I have tried to tell you about the psychological techniques that you should use to make the most out of your potential. I have also penned down one book which is called Tale of Two IAS. I think in my introduction it was not mentioned that my husband is also from the IAS. This is a Dinesh Goyal. And both of us have written down this book to trace that from the childhood itself, what it takes to become career oriented. And it's not just career which is for your sake, but it's a career where you want to give it back to the society which has given you so much to bring you to this level. Today, that you are educated, that you are having the ability to go in for this kind of competitive exam shows that you have got enough from the society to be at this level. And now, once you get into the IAS, what is it that you can do for the civil service? I have with me a young, bright colleague, Akash here, Dr. Akash. Just a very strange coincidence. I wanted to be a doctor. My father said, if you want to be in the medicine, then don't think about the IAS. So I said, all right, I want to be in the IAS because he was an IAS officer. So I went towards that. But after I got into the IAS, I said, I wanted doctor in front of my name. So I did a PhD. And now I'm Dr. Shalini Vaidyanathan. But this guy is a doctor by medicine qualification. And he wanted to be in IAS. So I will leave the floor for Dr. Akash. Next 5 minutes, he will quickly tell you what is it that you need to prepare, because it's the latest entry, and he should tell you what the latest requirements of the subject are. We will leave solid 15 minutes for question and answer, because that's what is more important. What is going on in your mind? How can we help you clarify your doubts? Akash, over to you.
Thank you, ma'am.
At the top of the world, you know everything around. You are so confident that any difficult situation that comes before you, you are able to solve it like this. That's the level of, you know, confidence and the responsibility that is infused in you. So let's begin with the questions that are in your mind. Yes, please quickly pass on the mics to the people.
Good afternoon, ma'am. This question actually I want to ask on behalf of my son. My son is 15 years old. He just passed his 10th exam in going to 11th class. So he's aspiring to become a civil servant since he was 11 years old. And he very specifically wants to become a diplomat, so which he wants to clear IFS in the foreign service. My question to you and to Dr. Akash is, is it necessary that he has to do a graduation in maybe from IIT, or he has to become a doctor to clear the IAS exam, or he can do any plain graduation?
The minimum qualification required is a BA, a degree, a graduation degree, that's all. Graduation in anything. Even your correspondence course, you are a graduate, you are eligible to apply. So any stream of his choice, let him select. He just has to be a graduate and 21 year old before he appears for the exam.
Like Dr. Agarwal said, the final test is the personality test. Once you clear the prelim and the mains. So does it make difference, or do you have age if you are from IIT or you are a doctor during the personality test?
See, it makes a difference when you have got better exposure, no doubt. You are in the IIT means you really got exposed to a large number of things, but that doesn't matter. There's no such comparison saying that if you are an IIT graduate or you are a medical doctor, you cannot compete with, say, if I was only a BA in psychology, right? It's not like that. It's your personality. See, they're not checking your qualification. It's only a minimum qualification, all right? They're checking your personality. They're checking your mental, disposition. They're checking your attitudes. They're checking your knowledge. So you have to select one subject of your choice. So whichever the subject in which the degree is done, that subject, that person has to be thorough. It's not that suppose your child has selected psychology as a subject, he will not be asked questions on to that level in maybe science or biology or something like that. So you have to be very prepared on that. But on the general studies, everybody has to be equally prepared. And as Akash also said, from 10th onwards, if your child starts preparing on these lines, nobody can stop him.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. And a father like you who's with him. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, please. Any other question?
Yeah. Good afternoon, ma'am. My name is Umaka. My question is to you, Dr. Shalini. I have my two kids here. I just brought them here so that they can exposure about what various fields are there, what opportunities.
Let them stand up and show up. Yeah, continue with the question.
Yes.
Good. Oh, girls.
Yes.
3 cheers for you, girls. Yes.
Beach and Natasha. So my question, I have two things to ask of you. One is the civil services, we all know, are full of brilliant officers. Okay, but the fact is that the bureaucracy reports to the political class. The question to you is, how do you deal with the political interference and then the pressures that come from the political class? What sort of pressures, I know you're smiling, right? So what sort of pressures they put on you and how do you handle it is one. The second thing is, I would like you to cite, we know that the civil, at least I know, and most of the adults here would know, that the civil services deals with policy formulation, with implementation of developmental programs and all. But I would like you to cite a couple of instances where you had implemented something,
sure.
and tell what sort of a societal impact it has had.
Sure.
So these kids will be able to relate to that.
Wonderful.
Thank you.
Number one is, you are having these apprehensions that tomorrow, once you get into the service, you are going to have this problem. Okay? I would say that this is one of the mental attitude that a civil servant should have. Number one, have confidence in your ability to do good. Do not have fear of failure. If you think others will interfere, others will put pressure on us, they will not allow us to do good, I think we are having a negative attitude. That is not what a civil servant should have. Once your attitude is positive, once your commitment is positive, nothing in the world can stop you. You wanted concrete examples from me. I was posted in Hyderabad, Karnataka area, Gulbarga, as most of you, Kalburgi, now it is called. It's the most backward area of the state of Karnataka. I created a think tank group and I prepared an action plan for the improvement of this backward area into a forward area, right? And that was compiled in the form of a book with the help of the Gulbarga University. And I'm very happy to mention to you that when a special constitutional status was being granted to Hyderabad Karnataka area, the parliament was looking at the pros and cons of giving this special status to Hyderabad Karnataka area. From the state government, I was sent to represent before the Rajya Sabha committee, chairperson and the members, to present what is the status of Hyderabad Karnataka area in its social economic field and what can be done, and to justify that a special status will help these people come up in life. And I have written a book on that, 371 amendment to the constitution for inclusive growth. I can give you another example on the field side. As a deputy commissioner of Belgaum district, now called Belgavi, we had unprecedented floods. Now, we got a notice of only 48 hours and there were 3 lakh people who had to be shifted out of their villages. Otherwise, within 48 hours, all their villages would have got marooned. You have seen recently in the Orissa cyclone, right? How Orissa government administration ensured that all there was no loss of life because they had a sufficient warning and they've been able to evacuate people and take them to a safe place. Now tell me, if I had to do this job as a deputy commissioner or a developmental person, is there any scope for political interference or pressure or something? No. Because most of the things, when you are doing good, everybody joins hands. At least I would say in last 30 years of my experience, I have not found anybody going against what I wish to do for the good of the people. If it is for the good of the people, if it is for the good of somebody only, yes, pressures will come, interference will come. So be committed to the good of the whole people, whole set of people, nobody will come in the way. And they will in fact join hands with you, they will support you. So always be with that and positive mindset and you will be at the success level. Okay, anything else?
Thank you, ma'am.
My question is to Mr. Akash. Since you have completed UPSC now, which is a taken, first question. Second thing.
You are truly at heart committed to the good of others. Nobody can stop you getting through the ethics exam. The ethics exam is not a direct question answer kind of thing. It's an indirect way of finding out your psyche. What you think inside, what's your thinking going on inside, what your belief system, what your attitudes, what your intentions are. If your intentions are good, they'll pick you up. They'll give you a good ranking. I think Akash should throw some light on that. Otherwise, it is tough, no doubt. But if you are well prepared, it's not tough. So be well prepared. That's the answer to the key.
And one last question. You itself, which is a better one, IELTS or IPS? I'm aspiring to become
an IELTS. I'll answer this question. If you are seriously interested, if you are seriously passionate about wearing a uniform, okay, and if you are holding the gun, wearing a uniform, if you seriously want to fancy that and enjoy all the perks and responsibilities, you can definitely go in for IPS. And I think many of us are very much moved by movies, and we see the lead actors in uniform performing very well, in action. Like how in the Kajal movie there is Ajay Devgan, who is an IPS officer. I was very much inspired by how he works and how his mindset was. So definitely it is your personal choice basically. My personal choice was IAS. You can't say which is better. Each has its own responsibilities, each has its own thread to its service.
But only thing I'll add is that if you want to be in the IAS, you should be in the top 100. Alright?
Which post has more power, IAS or IPS?
Sorry?
Which has more power? Like IAS or IPS?
Which has more power? Looking for power, go somewhere else. Both are powerful. Both are powerful. Power is to be used for the good of the people. Repeat this 10 times every night before you sleep. Next.
What are the subjects that are covered in the prelims?
Okay, so preliminary examination is the first stage, and wherein you have two papers, paper 1 and paper 2. Paper 1 is general studies, it's like general knowledge.
you have MCQs, 100 questions, 2 marks each. And second paper is Civil Services Aptitude Test, wherein you have mathematics and English comprehension. So even paper 2 is for 200 marks, 100 questions. So it just happens in one day. It's like you people attending your CET exams. One day writing 2 exams, morning in the afternoon session. So preliminary examination, paper 1, general knowledge, I said, there are different subjects which you have to cover. History, geography, economics, and basic sciences, and basically general knowledge. And most of the questions nowadays has been quite dynamic. They'll be asking you about current affairs, the recent current events that are ongoing across the world, basically. And your preparation should have to be from the foundation, from the basics, like reading NCERTs for the high school. We started preparing for this exam from 6th standard textbooks. We unlearn everything that we have learned till now, up till the degree, and then we start from the scratch again, from 6th standard NCERTs. So from the basics we start learning. And as I mentioned, all these subjects when we cover, we'll be able to attend the preliminary examination.
Okay, I'll just add to it. For the benefit of all of you, because you've not asked this question, now you are in the PU level, alright? You just cleared your 10. My suggestion to all those who are interested in appearing after 5 years now, about 3 to 5 years you'll be appearing. So you have to create a timetable from today onwards that in next 3 years or 4 years I am going to cover this syllabus. Go to a bookshop, get the UPSC syllabus, there's a booklet, or you can go online from the internet also, you can download it. Number one, get hold of your 9th and 10th standard, all the books means history, civics, your geography, science, everything, maths. Please refresh all your 10th and 9th standard books, number one. Number two, get onto 2 newspapers every day. Not necessary you have to get it at home, go to the library. Pick 2 newspapers, one in the regional language, one in English language. I would suggest that you make notes of the current events. That is for your mains I'm talking about. You should know about a subject in detail, but you should make small notes about, let us say, election 2019. What were the highlights? What led to that? Okay? So in the editorial page particularly, the newspapers would give you that idea. Please make bullet points. Alright, because this will come to you very handy after 3 years and 5 years, you will know the trends of that current affairs topic. Third thing is about the prelims, general knowledge. How do you prepare for general knowledge? General knowledge, there's no limit. You know, general knowledge is about sports, about anything under the sky. So there are some books which are available like India 2017, 18, 19 series. There is Manorama publication on civil services. Like that, if you go to the library, you will get some such publications. Please go on reading 5, 10, 20 pages every day. There are about 2,000, 3,000 pages books. So this will have chapter on every subject. Alright? So again, try and make notes of those general knowledge points, which will help you very handy in your prelims, because prelims are objective type questions. So you are asked for, you know, is it now multiple type? Is it multiple type? Multiple. Multiple choice. So you have to tick mark the right answer, and there is the negative marking now. There is a negative marking, so you have to be very sure about the negative marking. And as far as your subject is concerned, my strategy was sit in the library, get into the whole shelf of my subject, pick up the books, randomly add a new thought and make notes. So keep making notes on general studies, on your subject of choice and your general knowledge areas. Wish you all the best. One last question.
Good afternoon. Hello. Just one small question for my daughter and all the kids over here. So the critical thinking is the one actually that is more essential, as you were mentioning in your session in the initial time, that you should be very sharp enough to understand the situation, quickly respond to the situation. And also Dr. Akash was mentioning, the officer should be imbibed inside yourself before you even appear or think of appearing in the examination. Both are very much matching to the critical thinking. Any quick tips for the students, how they can improve their critical thinking in their current studies itself, studies time itself?
See, how to improve critical thinking? I'll just start with answering the question, the previous question basically. And she asked, what are the subjects that are there? I'll just tell you something. For attending any examination as such, you will have to basically go through the syllabus, what is there, and the previous year's questions. These two things are, this will break all the barriers, all the doubts that you have in your mind. And then you approach, then you start focusing on the exam, and during the process you plan things. So as madam said, plan for the next 3-4 years. Exactly this was our strategy also. So when I sit today and if I have to appear for the exam in the month of December, I will know what I'm going to do in these 6 months. I will know what I'm going to do in the next 1 month, the next 1 week, and today also. So you have to have short term, long term, and strategic and the far term plans also. So for improving critical thinking, basically you'll have to first focus, and whatever it is, take one step at a time, take one day at a time, and you have to practice concentrating basically. And every day, people of this age, 11th, 12th, when you enter your college, to have focus and determination for becoming a civil servant, you need to be in touch with the current affairs. Start reading 2 newspapers, as madam said, at least 1 newspaper every day, and at least 1 magazine every week. You have Civil Services Chronicle and Competition Success in Today. There are a number of magazines as such. At least 1 magazine per week, 1 newspaper per day, continuously for the rest of your time till you become an officer. So that's what is important. So here you have discipline and punctuality, and we practice this every day. And while reading your newspaper, it's not so easy to go through a long write-up. You have to concentrate. So practice concentration. All these things will actually improve your qualities as an officer, and one day definitely you'll be clearing the exam.
Just to add to what Dr. Akash said, critical thinking is you think into or more different aspects, right? All of you have participated into debates and declamations in your school or now college. Now, every aspect has pro and against arguments, isn't it? So, do not stick to one line of thinking. You should be able to be open to different views on the same subject. That is what you should practice by having a small study group of like-minded students, and you discuss the subject. So, when you study on one current topic, 4 or 5 of you sit and talk it out. One will say something, another will say something else. So you will get different perspectives of a same topic. That is what makes your mind open to different thinking, and that will make you make it possible for you to do critical thinking, because then you have to weigh plus points, minus points, which is the best decision. So this is the way to go. I think we should thank Times of India. It's time for the next session. And wish you all the best. My website is www.shalini.ias. My books are there on my website. E-books are there. Anytime, my email ID is there. Anytime you feel you need to have any further guidance, feel free to send me an email to my personal ID. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Cynthia. I thank the Times Group. I thank Dr. Shalini Rajneesh Madam. And I thank for the patience of all of you sitting here and listening to, and you can have my email ID, and I'm also on Facebook as well as Instagram. I definitely will be able to respond back whenever I see a message. So please drop in doubts that you have, and thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Shalini and Dr. Akash. Ladies and gentlemen, can I please hear a loud round of applause for them?
Well, it's always the toughest. So you are brightest, you have a toughest civil services exams to face.
Is it the same the way you wrote that time and selected?
Things have been changing a little. For example, during my time, there were two subjects to be chosen. Now it's only one subject and general studies. So I think to that extent, it's easier because you have to focus only on one subject. But then you have wider area, wider knowledge on the general studies side. So you have to be prepared on that. And the addition now is on ethics. I was waiting for a question like this. Please remember, as I mentioned to the previous question on answer also, that your ethics has to be very strong. Why are you